Museum of Design. Thank you all for coming, and I hope you enjoyed the exhibition. The exhibition will be up through April. I want to invite you back on April 20th at 5:30 for a book signing. The book on which the exhibition is based will be out soon, but we definitely know it will be here on the 20th for sale and to be signed by the author. So please do return on the 20th for that. The exhibition is one of a series of exhibitions that the Goldstein Museum of Design does here in the HGA galleries. I hope you get a chance to go down to the lower level of the gallery and see the Close Associates exhibition, Close Associates at 80. And then our small exhibition of our student apparel design seniors is down the hall in the HGA link. We at Goldstein Museum of Design, we are Minnesota's design museum. We're the only dedicated design museum in the state of Minnesota. And we do exhibitions here in Rapson Hall. We also do exhibitions over on the St. Paul campus in McNeil Hall. So if you get a chance, go to the St. Paul campus. Right now we are featuring Initial Impressions. It's a typography exhibition of initials from Renaissance books. So something of design history. We don't usually go back that far. This is kind of a special exhibition for us. But tonight we are here for a special talk and a panel discussion, and I'd like to introduce Kathleen Stocker.
Thank you. All right. Hi, everyone. Welcome. Because this is a joint event with Docomomo and with the Goldstein Museum, first, I'd like to say thank you to Lynn. It's great to partner with you on this. Second, for those of you who are not familiar with Docomomo, our mission is to document and conserve sites and buildings of the modern movement. So we host a number of events, and we do advocacy work with that goal. So if you're not familiar with our group, if you'd like to sign up or learn more about membership, there's materials outside. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce the first part of our program. So, Jane King Hessian wrote the book on Elizabeth Close Shoe. Okay, so you'll get the pronunciation right. So what I'm going to do is introduce Jane and then turn it over to her so we can learn a little more background. And then following that, we'll have a panel discussion. And then we'll close by taking questions from the audience. So Jane is a Minnesota-based architectural historian specializing in modernism. She earned her MArch from the University of Minnesota. A former president of the Frank Lloyd Wright Building Conservancy, she's the co-author of John H. Howe Architect, From Taliesin Apprentice to Master of Organic Design. Also, she wrote a book on Ralph Rapson and Frank Lloyd Wright in New York, The Plaza Years. And then after meeting and getting to know Elizabeth Lisl should have practiced that one, Jane became convinced that Lisl's remarkable life and career merited a book and resolved to be the one to write it. So now I'll turn it over to her to hear more about it. Thank you, Jane.
Thank you. Can everyone hear me, first of all? You can hear me up there? Yes? Okay. I also want to thank Docomomo for conceiving this program, with special thanks to Catherine Stocker, Camille Lefever, and Karen Rue, and also to Lynn Nelson Mason for inviting me to guest curate the exhibition. And to Sue Jin Kang for her expert design work and attention to detail on the exhibition. And also to the panelists you will meet in a few moments, Jean Ray Camp Larson and Julia Robinson, who will join us in a few moments. Elizabeth Shoy Close lived 79 of her 99 years in the United States, and most of them in Minnesota, where she established the first architectural practice devoted to modern design in the state. But her life began, and the seeds of the architect she would become were planted an ocean away in Vienna, which was then the Austro-Hungarian Empire. She was born in 1912 to a well-to-do family in Vienna during the last years of the reign of Emperor Franz Joseph I. Now, architecturally at that time, Vienna was a city characterized by the Baroque splendor of many palaces and baronial villas that stood in the city, including Schönbrunn Palace, which you see here, which was a summer residence of the Habsburgs. Now it's a UNESCO World Heritage Site. However, political and architectural change was coming to the city. By 1919, the Habsburg rule had ended, and the Social Democrats had gained political control of the city. This period of Social Democratic rule between 1919 and 1934 is known as Red Vienna. The Scheu family was deeply involved in the politics of Red Vienna. In fact, Liesl's grandfather was a founder of the Austrian Social Democratic Party, and he composed that organization's work song. When the Social Democrats assumed power, they were faced with a city suffering many deprivations from World War I, including severe housing shortages. And during this period, Gustav Scheu, whom you see here, Liesl's father, served as housing advisor to the city and dedicated himself to providing shelter for those in need. Scheu, a lawyer, was well qualified to do so. He had a long-standing interest in housing and city planning, and prior to World War I, he had traveled to England to study the Garden City movement with British town planning visionaries Ebenezer Howard, Raymond Unwin, and others. On one occasion, he enlisted the services of his six-year-old bilingual daughter, Lisl, whom you see here nervously clutching the back of her dress, in the housing relief effort. She was enlisted to welcome a somber assemblage of dignitaries to Vienna, among whom were American representatives of the European Children's Relief Fund, who were bringing life-saving aid to the city, especially the children of Vienna. Both Gustav Scheu, who you see on the left, and his wife Helena Scheu-Ries, an author, translator, and publisher of children's books, were politically and socially well-connected. And among their friends was iconoclastic architect Adolf Loos, the impressive man at the center of the photograph there. In 1912, the year of Liesl's birth, the Scheus commissioned Loos to design a house for their family in the Hietzing neighborhood of Vienna, about a mile from Schönbrunn Palace, which I just showed you. The Scheus were ideal clients for Loos, and Loos was the best possible architect for the Scheus. All three were nonconformists and intrepid personalities who were completely uninterested in current architectural styles. Now, when the Scheus hired Loos, he was at the center of a firestorm of controversy. Loos, who famously rejected ornamentation and railed against the architects who favored it, had recently designed Michaeler House, a multi-story retail apartment building in Vienna, which stood across from the Palace of the Habsburgs. At the heart of the controversy was the building's facade, which lacked adornment. This ignited outrage among the public and city officials alike. An injunction to block construction of the building was lifted on the condition that flower boxes be hung on its upper windows. The starkly modern house that Loos designed for the Scheus provoked more controversy, and it was an unwelcome insertion into its traditional Viennese neighborhood. The house has a stepped conformation because Loos included outdoor terraces on the upper two levels of the house, and they were accessible from indoor rooms. For this reason, the house is nicknamed the Giant Staircase. The terraces, believed to be the first of their kind in a residence in Central Europe, were nothing less than an architectural and cultural affront. Of them, Loos later wrote, "Years ago, I built the house of Dr. Gustav Scheu in Hietzing, Vienna. It aroused general disapproval. One person went to the municipal council to ask if this type of building were permitted by law." Lisl lived in this house for the first 20 years of her life. Now, according to Lisl, her mother had a very hard time getting a building permit, and the city granted one only on the condition that the Scheus grow ivy up the bare white exterior of the house. However, Loos often wrapped his facades of his villas in a tangle of vines, as he believed the greenery provided a kind of protective skin on the house, akin to fur on an animal or clothing on a human. It offered a measure of privacy and security from neighbors' gazes. But Loos also made a clear distinction between the outside or public facade of the house and the inside, which he believed where individuality could be expressed. This counterpoint is evident in the Scheu house, where the stark geometry and white shell of the outside is counterpointed deliberately by warm textured interiors, including this inglenook. According to Lisl, Loos selected all the materials and finishes for the house. His choice of oak intentionally lacked the gloss and shine of the more opulent materials he sometimes chose, like lacquered mahogany or polished stone that he specified for other projects. And this was because he was sensitive to a homeowner's character and aware of how that client wanted to leave an impression on his or her guests. In the case of the Scheu house, the simple finishes stressed the vital meaning of family in Gustav Scheu's life and suited the social democratic principles that the Scheus professed. The bookcase-lined rooms and multiple intimate seating areas also fostered conversation and gathering at the couple's frequent salons. In addition to being a family home, the Scheu house was an architectural magnet for those interested in modern design, and people came from all over the world to see it. The day they moved into the house, Lohs presented the Scheus with a guest book, which he was the first to sign. Actually, he wrote a two-page essay, but that's a detail. From that day forward until 1967, visitors to the house signed, wrote, drew, painted in the guest book, thereby documenting the astonishing array of artists, journalists, writers, politicians, suffragists, and many others whose conversation enlivened the house for more than a half century. Many were or would later become world famous. More than a handful would perish in concentration camps. One of the many noted visitors to the house was American expatriate and poet Ezra Pound, who signed the book and added a whimsical self-portrait in 1928. The book offers an indelible impression from the perspective of one family and one remarkable house of the richly creative, politically volatile city that was Vienna between, before, and after two world wars. Lisl returned the guest book to Vienna, the city where it was born, in 2001. Lisl claimed to have been indoctrinated by the house, and she said the experience of growing up in it convinced her to become an architect and study modern design. I've forgotten my pointer, but Lisl is seated on the arm of the sofa at the left, and in front with the glasses on is her brother, Friedel. This was not an easy path for a woman in Vienna in the late 1920s. To put the boldness of her decision in perspective, Lisl did not know of a single female architect in Vienna or Europe when she committed to architectural studies. There were, however, a handful of architects practicing in Europe at the time, although their work was not widely published, if it was published at all. One of them was Irish-born Eileen Gray, a furniture designer and self-trained architect whose designs include the E1027 house in southern France. German-born Lily Reich, a self-taught architect who frequently collaborated with Ludwig Mies van der Rohe on furniture designs and interiors, including those in the Tugendhat house in what is now the Czech Republic. French architect and designer Charlotte Perriand, known for her chrome and glass furniture and ski resort designs, among many other accomplishments. Although in her first attempt to gain employment with Le Corbusier, he dismissed her explaining, "We don't do embroidery here." He later relented, and for years they collaborated on multiple furniture designs, interiors, including that of Unité d'Habitation in Marseille. And it was only much later in life that Lisl learned about Margareta Schuda-Lohotsky, the Viennese-born architect who was 15 years Lisl's senior, trained in Vienna, but left that city for the Soviet Union in 1926 when Lisl was 14. A member of the Communist Party, she was arrested and imprisoned during World War II for her activism activity in the resistance. She's best known for her design of the Frankfurt kitchen, a functional, efficient rethinking of the kitchen that was engineered to ease a woman's domestic burden in the home. More than 10,000 of the units were mass-produced and installed in apartment buildings in Frankfurt and other cities. The one you see here is in the collection of the Minneapolis Institute of Arts. Schuda-Lohotsky died in 2000 at the age of 102. Lisl began her education at the Technische Hochschule in Vienna, but found the faculty there hostile to women. She faced another even more serious problem in Vienna in the early 1930s. Helena, Lisl's mother, was Jewish by birth, and even though she did not raise her children as Jews, it was a dangerous point to debate in Austria at the time. So with the financial help and support of a family friend and frequent visitor to the Scheu house, Edward Filene of the Boston department store family. Lisl left Vienna in 1932 and moved to the United States to continue her education at MIT. By 1935, she had earned both her bachelor's and master's degrees there. In 1932, the year Lisl arrived at MIT, the Museum of Modern Art in New York staged its groundbreaking show, Modern Architecture International Exhibition, a show that effectively introduced Americans to European modern architecture and popularized the term international style. It's unknown if Lisl saw the exhibition, but she would have been familiar with the work of many of the practitioners included in the show, including Walter Gropius, Mies van der Rohe, Le Corbusier, and Richard Neutra, to name a few. Her own work was influenced by the international style in its preference for volume over mass, planar surfaces, rejection of ornamentation, and embrace of machine age technologies and materials. But her design aesthetic was also influenced by other European modern movements. Just before leaving Vienna for the United States, Lisl had the opportunity to visit the Werkbundsiedlung, an experimental housing development built a little over a mile from her home. Organized by architect Josef Frank, a leading promoter of Viennese modernism and a Scheuerhaus guest, the exhibition featured 70 single-family dwellings and row houses designed by Frank, Loos, Neutra, Schuder-Lohotsky, Josef Hoffmann, and other influential Austrian modernists. For Lisl, the Siedlung was an opportunity to consider the ways in which multiple architects applied modern ideas and new technologies to residential design. It was also a built expression of the Neues Bauen, or the new building era in Vienna. The movement was not primarily concerned with aesthetic or theoretical principles of form and design, but focused rather on the individual needs of inhabitants. These principles resonated with Lisl. While at MIT, Lisl was invited by a fellow student to accompany her on a cross-country driving trip, which Lisl described as her first powerful encounter with American architecture. These are her photographs that you see here, and she photographed numerous man-made and natural wonders on these trips, on this trip. Interestingly enough, she found modernity in the strong, simple lines of the Assisi Mission Church in Taos, which you see on the left, completed in 1816, and the Hoover Dam, an engineering marvel on the Arizona-Nevada border, which was still under construction at the time of her visit. Of the church, she said, "It was the first building that really made me excited about American architecture." The women also traveled to Los Angeles, where Lisl photographed the 1929 Lovell House and other recent works by architect Richard Neutra, a fellow Austrian. Lisl had the misfortune to enter the job market during the Great Depression, the worst economic downturn in American history. She further limited her job options by restricting her search to firms that did only modern work. She applied to three firms. New York-based William Lascaz at Left refused to hire her because he feared a woman would be a distraction in the drafting room. Richard Neutra at Center, who was a family friend and had been a guest in her home in Vienna, said she was welcome to come work for him, but she would have to pay him a monthly fee for the privilege. Finally, she applied for work with the Philadelphia-based firm of Kastner and Stonaroff. Oscar Stonaroff hired her. During their interview, or her interview, the two bonded over shared European backgrounds, socialist leanings, and modern design preferences. For Stonaroff, Lisl worked on Westfield Acres in Camden, New Jersey, a federally funded housing project for more than 500 families. Lisl admired Stonaroff's humanistic attitude when it came to housing design. He thought more about the people who were going to live there instead of the bureaucrats who were running the place, she said. Specifically, she was assigned to draft the children's facility. At the invitation of her MIT graduate school classmate and future husband, Winston Close, Lisl moved to Minneapolis in 1936 and joined him as a designer for Magny and Tussler, one of a consortium of firms working on Sumner Field. Like Westfield Acres, Sumner Field's homes was a federally funded low-income housing project comprising multiple residential blocks. Lisl was assigned to work on the building's elevations, and although she had been instructed what to do and what not to do, she did not follow instructions to the letter. Instead, she ignored directives and added certain features that she believed would provide a more pleasurable living experience for residents, notably balconies, because she felt it was important if you live in an apartment to be able to go outside or to air your baby. Predictably, her superiors were not pleased by her architectural insubordination. In 1938, Lisl and Wynne is at center with his legs crossed, left Magny and Tussler and founded Close and Shoy, the first and only at the time architectural practice in Minnesota dedicated to modern design. After they married 2 years later, the firm's name became Elizabeth and Winston Close Architects, and today it is known as Close Associates. And that's the exhibit that's on the lower level here. Lisl and Wynne collaborated on the firm's early projects. However, in 1946, after serving in the Navy during World War II, Wynne embarked on a teaching career at the University of Minnesota. He would eventually serve as head of campus planning and the university's advisory architect. In that capacity, he led several major campus expansion efforts, including the master planning of the university's new West Bank campus and Washington Avenue Bridge in Minneapolis, and its campuses in Duluth and Morris, among many other initiatives. So between 1946 and 1971, when Wynne retired from the university, Lisl ran the firm and was the head architectural designer. These two housing projects, captured in watercolor perspectives by Lisl, were among the closest first projects. Atop is a study for University Terrace, a low-cost 16-unit development planned for a site in Falcon Heights. For the Cooperative Housing Study Group, shown below, they explored a project that strove to provide better housing at low cost through cooperative efforts and group ownership. Among its fundamental principles were unrestricted membership with no discrimination for race, religion, color, or politics, something that could not have been said of all Twin Cities communities at the time. Neither project was built. Close and Shoy's first built work was the 1938 Faulkner House, which stands at the end of Bedford Street in Prospect Park in Minneapolis. It was commissioned by three bachelor professors at the University of Minnesota, Ray Faulkner, Gerald Hill, and Edwin Ziegfeld. All taught courses in contemporary art or music, and they were well informed about modern design and wanted to build a modern house. Of the collaboration, historian Lauren Soth has said, all five individuals were committed to modernism in the arts. The house they collaborated on was a physical manifesto of their beliefs. Because the house consisted of uncomplicated volumes and flat roofs, materials that fit the very simple character of the residence were chosen. The exterior was sheathed in a combination of horizontal redwood siding and resin-bonded plywood. The reserved exterior of the Faulkner House belied its warm, textural interior. Finishes included brick, gumwood veneer, and homasote, a material more commonly used to side train cars than in residential design. But the Closes appreciated the handsomeness, durability, and dimensions of the material. The Faulkner House was the first house in Minneapolis to be influenced by the international style. And like the Shoy House in Vienna, it was considered by many to be a stylistic interloper in its traditional neighborhood. As such, it initiated debate in the Twin Cities about the merits of modernism to residential design and strong opinions on the subject. In fact, when a passerby suffered a fatal heart attack in front of the house, you can't make this up, the Minnesota Daily speculated that the shock of seeing the modern residence just might have been responsible for the cardiac arrest. For some people, however, a modern house, one suited to contemporary lifestyles, was exactly what they wanted and were looking for. Word of mouth about the Faulkner House, particularly among University of Minnesota faculty members, generated a string of new residential commissions for the firm of Close and Shoy. The Red Wing Medical Clinic, completed in 1940, was the Close's first commercial commission. The building, known as the Interstate Clinic, was a fusion of functional design, state-of-the-art medical technology, and world-class modern art. The exterior of the L-shaped building was wrapped in glazed white tile and plywood. Public areas of the building displayed oversized, highly abstract artwork, including this one titled Number 7 New York by renowned Minnesota artist and Red Wing resident Charles Biederman, who was related by marriage to the doctors who commissioned the clinic. The artwork provided an effective counterpoint to the stripped-down white walls of the waiting room, and in other areas of the building, the closest used birch plywood to handsome effect. You're looking at the pharmacy on the right. In the late 1960s, the Interstate Clinic had outgrown its original facility and moved to another site, and the building was demolished in 1985. In 1941, Joseph Beach, the head of the university's English department, and his wife Dagmar, a writer, asked the closest to design a small cabin for an isolated site on the St. Croix River near Osceola, Wisconsin. The location of the site, on a bluff high above the river, inspired the cabin's poetic name, Skywater, as Dagmar believed it stood midway between sky and water. The design was essentially a question: should the cabin be dug into the hill like a cave or project out from it like a treehouse? They ultimately decided to build into the hill on a ridge high above the river. The 576 square foot sod roof cabin was constructed of redwood and stone, and the stone was gathered on site. The slim budget for the cabin necessitated a great deal of creativity on the part of the closes. Inexpensive hollow tile was used for flooring, stone and plywood for walls, and a trash can recessed in the earthen wall of the kitchen served as a rustic refrigerator. There was no running water or electricity, and access to the cabin in the winter was impossible. The Beaches allotted an additional $50 for furniture and other necessities. The closest came up with an ingenious low-cost design in which one chair and one table could be produced from a single sheet of plywood. And once it was assembled, clothesline was strung across the frame to create its back. In 1961, Lisl designed a second cabin at Skywater, this time projecting the cabin out from the hillside. The light frame structure included the amenities of electricity, running water, a screen porch, and a bathroom. In 1983, the closes purchased Skywater from the Beaches, and it remains in the close family today. 15 houses designed by the closes stand in University Grove, an exceptional neighborhood of 103 single-family homes built on University of Minnesota-owned land in Falcon Heights. The Grove was established in 1928 when the university set aside an attractive parcel of land for an academic housing village. To foster residences of similar size and scale, a cost cap was applied to each house. A requirement at the Grove, which was built over a 40-year period, was that all houses be designed by an architect. For this reason, the neighborhood contains residences in a wide range of styles, from English Tudor to California modern. And this stylistic diversity prompted the New York Times to describe the unique neighborhood as an architectural time capsule. The closes designed more houses in the Grove than any other architect or firm, four of which are pictured here. Other contributing architects include Edwin Lundy, Liebenberg and Kaplan, Carl Graffender, and Ralph Rapson, to name but a few. The firm's first Grove house was a 1939 residence for education professor Tracy Tyler. The design of the Tyler residence, like every close design house, was grounded in an understanding of the site's characteristics. According to Lisl, the early work of the firm pioneered the contemporary approach to design with emphasis on conservation of topography, trees, use of natural materials, and blending of house and site. By 1953, Wynn's faculty and administrative positions at the university had made the close family eligible to build a house in the Grove. And like the Tyler house, the two-story close house was built into a sloped site. Because the land rose towards the back of the lot, main living areas were placed on the second floor, and the exterior is wrapped in redwood siding, which at the time was an affordable material and a durable one. In all, Lisl designed more than 250 modern residences during her long career. Among them was the 1964 Oscom residence, a butterfly-roofed house in the Indian Hills neighborhood of Edina. The interior of the house features an open plan in which entry, dining room, study, and living room freely flow. And thanks to the extraordinary efforts of 90-plus-year-old Mari Oscom, the original owner of the house, who feared her home would be a teardown upon her death, the house is now an Edina Heritage Landmark, the only modern property so designated in that city. In 1941, Page and Hill, a company that had gotten its start in Minnesota producing utility poles, hired Lisl to design prefabricated homes needed by the Defense Department to house war workers. They hired her on the strength of her MIT undergraduate thesis, which was a production plan for prefabricated housing. Post-war, she continued to design for Page and Hill, creating models that appealed to a new generation of homeowners, notably GIs returning from the war and their families. Between 1941 and the late 1950s, more than 10,000 houses of her design were produced, shipped, and built across a 15-state area. You're looking at the Page and Hill factory in Shakopee, and people are actually assembling the houses in this photo. The design and production of a Page and Hill prefab house involved a lot of complications that differed from those required in conventional construction. First among them was each house was required to be designed to pack and ship in one single truckload. According to Lisl, the houses were ordinary, inexpensive, and not very modern. But they did address a very contemporary need, which was rapid production of affordable housing that could quickly populate new neighborhoods. The models varied in size and design and bore such vaguely evocative names as Hiawatha, Jubilair, and Devonshire, to name a few. Once parts were shipped to a waiting foundation on a homeowner's lot, the houses could be assembled in a few weeks. The company's record from model sale to move-in was 27 days. Entire neighborhoods of Page and Hill homes appeared across the upper Midwest. Twin Cities examples include Acorn Ridge in Minnetonka and Vista View in Burnsville. In addition, more than 1,000 units were shipped to Minnesota's Iron Range to house an influx of taconite industry workers, including to the newly incorporated town of Hoyt Lakes. Now, Lisl may have characterized her prefab designs for Page and Hill as just ordinary houses, but during the Cold War, one played an extraordinary role in a highly publicized propagandistic display of the benefits of life under the American system of democracy. In 1950, the U.S. State Department selected a Jubilair model to represent the typical American home at the Berlin International Industrial Exhibition. It was shipped to Berlin in 94 crates and assembled in 10 days. The stated purpose of the model American home was to graphically represent the high living standard of the American wage earner, and by extension, the fruits of American democracy and free enterprise. More plainly stated, it was intended to demonstrate that life was better in the free world and to make that point behind the Iron Curtain. More than 43,000 people visited the house during the fair's two-week run. The house was fully equipped with the most current conveniences and marvels of American domestic life, most of which seem miraculous to the residents of war-torn Berlin. They included a thermostat-controlled furnace, electric range, washing machine, vacuum cleaner, television, and a mix master. The State Department declared the achievement of the house to be the gratifying demonstration of what can be accomplished in selling the American democratic way of life. Lisl is not mentioned in any State Department correspondence or records, nor was she credited for the design of the house in any of the 125 tons of propaganda material that was disseminated during the fair. In addition to her residential work, Lisl designed numerous commercial buildings. One of the smallest is a 1959 park structure for Boston Field for the Minneapolis Park and Recreation Board. It's currently being restored for continued use. In the 1950s and 60s, she designed a series of medical buildings in the Twin Cities, including the Metropolitan Medical Center, a joint venture with the Minneapolis firm of Horty Elving and Associates, and the 1966 PV Technical Center in Chaska, which was a research facility dedicated to product development. The Freshwater Biological Institute in 1971 on Lake Minnetonka in Navarre, which was designed as a laboratory for freshwater research. And after Wynn's retirement from the university, he and Lisl collaborated on the design of Ferguson Hall, the music school at the University of Minnesota, completed in 1986. It was their only university building and one of their final projects. Lisl disliked being labeled a woman architect, preferring an architect who happens to be a woman. Yet she achieved many firsts as a woman in the field, and she was the first woman to serve as the president of AIA Minnesota. In 2002, she became the first woman and the 13th recipient of AIA Minnesota's gold medal, the highest honor that institution bestows. She died in 2011, 6 months short of her 100th birthday. And although she was not a standard bearer for feminism and did not think of herself as a role model, in her determination, persistence, talent, and accomplishments, she paved the way for a generation of women architects who followed in her path. It's a gift that Georgia Bisios, an architect who worked for her, does not take for granted. By the time I worked for Lisl, she was well established. I valued that because I didn't have to prove to people that women could be architects. Lisl had already done that. Thank you.
Thank you, Jane. If our panelists could come up, I'll turn on the lights and we'll move over to the table here. Let's test out this microphone here. Do you want to say something?
Testing. Yes.
And I don't think you have to lean forward.
Okay.
Try it from here.
Okay. Can you hear us now if we just sit back? Okay, great.
Excellent. Okay, so we are here today with Jane, Julia Robinson, and Jean Ray Camp Larson. I'm gonna abbreviate the bios here. Is this too loud? It seems kind of loud.
No.
Is that right? Okay. So let's start with Julia. Julia Williams Robinson is a professor of architecture at the University of Minnesota and a registered architect. She has written many books, including Complex Housing, Designing for Density, Institution and Home, Architecture as a Cultural Medium, The Discipline of Architecture, and Programming as Design. She has been recognized by ASCA as a distinguished professor, and she's a fellow of the American Institute of Architects. Julia works part-time during the school year for Lisl Close as an intern when she was an undergraduate student and kept in contact with her over the years. She recommended Georgia Bisios to replace her as an intern, who worked at the office for many years. Julia attended the U of M at the same time as Gar Hargens, now the firm owner, and they worked together on projects. Julia was the first female faculty member and female tenured professor at the School of Architecture at the University of Minnesota. So thank you for being here, Julia. And then Jean Recamp Larson. Jean co-founded Recamp Larson Architects with her husband Mark Larson in 2000 with the vision of an inspired, collaborative, client-focused residential design practice. It's a firm of 14 people located in South Minneapolis. They have won many awards. Jean herself was a recipient of the AIA Young Architect Award and has been named Emerging Talent of the Year by Midwest Home Magazine. The firm has won rave awards. What's that?
That's a long time ago.
Was that a long time ago? Rave awards and Home of the Month awards. Jean is the recipient of the 2019 Architect of Distinction Award from AIA Minnesota. She wrote the book, The Farmhouse, New Inspiration for the Classic American Home, and has served on as a founding counselor of the Congress of Residential Architecture and a participant on the Custom Residential Architects Network of AIA. So she stays connected with a broader community of professionals in residential design. She received her bachelor's degree of architecture from the University of Minnesota and is from rural Marshall, Minnesota. So with introductions here, you know Marshall? we're here to talk, thank you so much, Jane, for setting the stage here, to talk more about the work and the legacy and the life of Lisl Close and what it means today to have had her be such a pioneer, both in bringing modern architecture to Minnesota and to be a woman in the field of architecture, which was very male-dominated in the 30s and continues to be still more men than women practicing architects. So we'll talk about modernism, we'll talk about women in architecture, we'll talk more about Lisl and her legacy. So let's start with personal connections. I know that each of the three of you have had a chance to connect with Lisl before she passed away and gotten to know her. So would you mind sharing some of the stories? What was she like? What were your interactions with her? Would you like to start, Julia?
Sure, okay. So I knew Lisl when I was a student, and she, so I worked in her office, which I remember as having a distinct odor of ammonia because of the blue line prints given to me. Many offices had that odor. And was it also designed by her. It's the office, I don't know if any of you recognize the office on Lake Street. No, it was Franklin Avenue. Franklin Avenue and what's the?
31st,
yes. And so it was a charming place to work, but full of natural light and a lot of wood design, and everything was wood and or plaster. And so it was a delightful place to work. And we were, she was very careful in who she hired, and we were very carefully supervised by the wonderful guys that worked there. And when I applied for the job, she was very open and very, very pleasant to assign me. But I must say that whilst I was working with her, working in the office, she was very quiet. And so it was, I didn't really always feel that it was not a, you were not buddies with your boss in that office.
Mm-hmm. I'll go next. I, 20 years ago, taught a class at the University of Minnesota, co-taught a class just for continuing ed called 10 Women, 2 Nights. And a colleague of mine, we talked about women in architecture. And one of those women was Lisl Close. And so I had the pleasure of going to her home and interviewing her. And I remember her at that point, she was probably 80, it was 1999, walking down her spiral stair and her graciously inviting me in and giving me a tour. And this whole panel prompted me to pull out some of the old photos. And I have these great photos of Lisl in her house showing off all the very particular specific things that she had designed for herself and her family.
Well, I met Lisl when she was 88 years old, and I was asked to do an oral history on her by the, is this too loud?
No.
By the Minnesota Historical Society. And I, like Jean, I went to her house and she opened the door and walked up the spiral staircase. And I should tell you at this point, Lisl was maybe 4'11", if that. And we sat in her living room over the course of a year and I talked to her about all manner of things. And Julia said she was quiet. I would say she was not extremely forthcoming or voluble. She would answer questions, but you know, with some people you can ask them one question and you know they answer it for an afternoon. With Lisl, she had very specific answers to questions. Her son Roy once described her as a diminutive woman in a hard hat. And I think that's a great image for Lisl because she was very tiny and I think people underestimated her because of her diminutive size. But she had a lot of steel and a lot of determination and she was a charming, delightful woman as well. But she was no nonsense about Lisl at all.
And so let's talk a little more about how their work was received. So Lisl and Wynn were the first modern architecture firm, as Jean pointed out, when they opened in 1938. It was an era where there were still a lot of historical references and ornament. And so how, over time, has the perception of their work changed? Like, for instance, when you were as an intern there, what do you think people thought about their work?
Well, I know that everybody knew who she was because when I mentioned I was working for her, there was no question that she was known in the profession.
Mm-hmm.
But I think her work was certainly, it was never talked about in school as you know, when you took history class, nobody ever talked about, any women architects for that.
Any local architects either.
And she was local. And but I think she was respected as a designer in the profession, so mm-hmm. that there was a trust of her work that it would be well done and so on.
And do you think it was a surprise when people came across it? You know, the heart attack story, was it? Were there some elements of it really standing out because it was something new?
Well, I guess by the time I came around, it wasn't new.
Okay, sure, right.
There wasn't much modernism in Minnesota in 1936 or 1938 when this house, well, there was practically none. So it was quite unusual for a house to be so stark and have a flat roof. I mean, you could not get a mortgage if you wanted a house with a flat roof. So it was not conventional in any way. Mm-hmm. However, I would say within the university, they had a lot of clients who were attracted to just this very thing. They wanted modern houses. So there was a group of people who was interested in modernism, but in general, it was not really embraced either by the profession or by the public at the time.
But mm-hmm. by the time I worked for her in the 60s,
right.
late 60s, she was established. There was an interest in that.
That's 30 years later.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it seems as if she also became well known for really responding to client needs.
Yes, absolutely.
There are a couple of clients in the audience today, and maybe during the question and answer period, they might respond to that, yeah. those questions.
Yeah, that'd be great. So she brought her knowledge of early European modernism to the United States, to Minnesota, started debates about that, and then went on to build so many houses in addition to other kinds of work. Is it possible to trace the influence of her work to other people or to the role of the spread of modernism in Minnesota? Do you have any thoughts about how her work continues to stay alive today?
Certainly, when you look at her work, you see the influences of the European modernists, but you also see the influences of what I think is Midwestern, right? So there's a humbleness about it and a simplicity about it that seems to be a combination, an intersection of those two things. So in that way, it feels like her, both the places that she inhabited, Vienna and here, and the Midwest, which has a sort of conservative flavor about it, right? Mm-hmm. So modern, but really simple in some way.
But I think that she represents a strain of architect that is not reflected in what's famous. She wasn't interested in fame. She wasn't interested in being a star architect. She was interested in designing buildings that people loved. And I think she was very successful in that way. Her buildings were not flashy. They were solid and well thought out and beautiful in a very simple and direct way rather than fancy and decorated, mm-hmm. as we saw.
Yeah. Well, and I also have heard that she didn't chase the publicity and there was no advertising.
Never advertised. I was going to say one of her favorite buildings was not a house. It was the Freshwater Biological Institute, which was a highly technical laboratory facility. And she felt that creating architecture was like solving a puzzle. And she liked just figuring out all the details of that. And she really took pride in sort of fulfilling someone's needs. And in this case, it was a laboratory.
So. And I have to say, as a student at the school where that was not at all emphasized, that was one of the pleasures of working for her, is that at school, nobody cared about what the people in the buildings were doing at that time. It was all about the form and whether the roof was flat or pitched was a big deal. Whereas she really was designing to solve human life problems about the height of a counter or the width of a desk. Those were very important things for her that we never discussed really at school.
That's interesting, yeah.
So that was a really nice counterpoint to my educational experience.
Well, definitely. So talking about the more complex projects, I have a quote here from Lisl. People had less reserves about letting a woman design a house or a residence or an apartment because it's not so formidable as a technical problem, she said. And so in trying to get a job, it makes it easier. So let's switch over, shift gears a little to women in architecture. And do you think that even still today, women are better received as architects in the residential field? How has that evolved since the time that Lisl started working and even all throughout her 50-year career?
Well, I can speak to my own experience, which is being a female residential architect. I ended right up in that field working for Mulfinger Sosenka early on. And so Maybe that is why, in part, it was an easy path for me as a female in architecture. I don't bear any weight of having it been hard. I joined a firm that had two female partners, and I had female professors in college, and I didn't expect anything else other than to be able to just move forward. But I have never worked at a commercial firm, so I don't know that half of the experience.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But Lisl, I'm sure, helped pave the way for that, right?
Yeah, to be a pioneer. Yeah.
And I will say it's no matter what kind of architect you are, it's challenging. So
it's... I guess I'm not surprised that she would felt that way. I think it was true that domestic things were considered females' territory at that time.
Mm-hmm.
So it would only be natural that she would be considered an expert in domestic things and maybe not so expert in other things.
Either. And she was not an expert in domestic things. She did not cook. She was very proud of that. She had someone who raised her children. Mm-hmm. So there's a little bit of irony there because that was domesticity was not her specialty.
Right. I love how in the book you point out that when she received her Lifetime Achievement Award, this AIA gold medal,
right.
She thanked her housekeeper and her nanny for being there with her for 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
And we got advanced copies of the book. I would highly recommend it. It really brings to life her as a person and her as an architect. But that's the topic of work-life balance. You know, so many people... women choose to leave the profession or don't stay in it as long or try to go down to part-time because of the demands of life outside of work. So
it's incredibly challenging. It's a profession that has a ton of passion and an unending amount of work that you can do. So I was jealous to hear that Lisl had a full-time housekeeper, right? We raised two children. Because my husband was an integral part in that. But I think many times I just... wondered how is it even possible to be doing all this because architecture is so intense and all-consuming. So
we were talking about this among ourselves, and one of the things that we were talking about was the fact that apparently she didn't feel any guilt.
No. That's a whole other book.
I didn't have that experience around
guilt. Well, Lisl was also raised by a professional mother, and she was raised by a nanny as well. So she had that model, and I would argue that freedom to follow that kind of a life.
And I think it probably took all that. Mm-hmm. Right? That is probably what made it possible, mm-hmm. especially as a pioneer in doing it. It really did probably take that to make the impact and to do the work that she did.
And one of the other things you were saying is that at your firm, you're very intentional about trying to provide work-life balance for your employees so as to not perpetuate that cycle.
It's true. And it's not easy because there's always more to do, as many of ours are, our female staff and male will attest to. It's an ongoing challenge to say, okay, well, we wanted to do all that work and we can't get it done and we still want to go home and have a life beyond this work life. So what has to give? How do we balance it? We talk about it every day because it comes up. Yeah.
Let's go back to so she had a mother who was a professional woman. She was an author and a publisher, so she had that example. But she didn't have very many women architects in her life to look up to help her make connections or get opportunities. How important is that in helping women succeed in the profession these days or in your own experiences? Julia, especially being the first female professor at the University of Minnesota School of Architecture, did you find that hard to blaze that trail on your own?
Of course it was hard. And actually it was very helpful to have worked for Lisl because I knew that she was well respected.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I was telling the group earlier, the way I got into teaching, of course, was through the back door because I had decided in my academic career as a student, I noticed that architects were doing no research. So when I was assigned to design a public housing project and I said, well, how do we know about what the people in this building need? They said, oh, don't worry about it. Just do what you think is best. And I was kind of shocked. So as one of my first projects, for our final project, we had to have a thesis, and we had a year to prepare. So I actually took a design studio where we actually went and interviewed I am a social work student, went and interviewed students, actually people who lived in the Phillips neighborhood, because the high school site was available then, where the Little Earth Project is now. This is before that was built. And so from my thesis, I did the design of a housing project on that very site, knowing full well that this was going to be something that was affecting me for the rest of my life. So I decided to study anthropology later and went back and then started advising students, because Ralph Rapson, when I left school, said, well, if you ever want to be an advisor, come on back. And I thought, what? But then it turned out that when I studied anthropology, being an advisor was a good job. So I came back, did it as an advisor, and then a colleague, Lance Levine, who was teaching at that time, running the first year studio, invited me to come and be a critic in the studio, and knowing full well that Ray Geiger, who was teaching at that time, was going to be required by Leonard Parker to do working drawings in the spring. So then I Lance invited me to sit on the reviews in the fall and winter, which I did. And then, of course, they needed someone to teach in the spring, and I knew all the projects that they had done, so they hired me to do it. So that was how I became the first female faculty.
Well, yeah. There's something about residential design that wasn't considered real architecture a little bit, right? Mm-hmm. So since we're talking about Leonard, well, I'll bring him up again. Leonard Parker would say to me early on, because my husband worked for Leonard at the time, oh, when are you going to come and do real architecture? And I was working on houses at the time and absolutely loving it and engaged So there was a little bit of that attitude mm-hmm. from the architects.
Yeah.
And that, of course, has changed, and we have an incredible residential architecture community now. But
speaking of Leonard Parker, one of the things that when I was working for Lisl, I was studying with Leonard Parker, and he was extremely unkind to me, and my designs never got any good grades from him. And I was complaining to Lisl, and apparently later on, about probably 15 years later, she was on a panel on television or on the radio or something with Leonard, and he said, oh, I don't think women should be architects, and she was absolutely shocked. And then she spoke to me when we ran into each other. She said, well, I didn't really believe you at the time, but Leonard showed his colors at his meeting.
But I will give him credit. He was a really great architect. He did great work. He was a great detailer. He
was a good architect, but he wasn't very nice to me.
So when she started architecture in the 1930s, there was some overt discrimination. There were some major roadblocks to her becoming an architect. Some of the stories we heard in the book about her not having women's restrooms at the university where she studied, or not having being assumed she was a secretary at the architecture firm, things like that. And then even in the 1950s, 20 years later, only 1% of registered architects were women. Today, the statistics are closer to 35%. But there's still a real lack of women in leadership roles in the firms. So the question on the table, do architects who are women still face discrimination?
Well, I think it was you should tell a little bit about the relationship with Winston and how she was treated.
Well, I think what I would say about that is that there's always been an assumption, perhaps, that they worked, that they shared responsibility on all of these projects. But when I interviewed clients and did the research, you realize Liesl was the one who was doing this. And that was because Wynne had another job, a full-time job. And she would say they would confer over dinner with their children. So they would, or on the weekend, they would compare notes. But they had really two separate jobs for 25 years. So, but I think sometimes that's lost a little bit. And, you know, it's all kind of lumped together in a Wynne and Liesl work. And really, in truth, for a 25-year period, most of the design was done by Liesl.
And she told me he looked over her shoulder, that's all.
Right.
When I interviewed her.
Right.
And that... Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so that's true for many, many mm-hmm. partnerships where women mm-hmm. and men have worked together. We know over history that there are many partnerships where the men get the credit and win the prizes, and the woman was doing half the work at least.
So, and I think that my brother, this has sent me an article just this week from Finance Magazine or something that talks about the disparity the difference between women and men in leadership positions in architecture firms. So apparently it's true. It does. But in our firm, we have equal women to men, if not more women, and equal women in what we call, it's a small firm of 14 people, but in our leadership positions are as many women as men. So, but it seems that there is still.
Definitely.
And I think it's great to see that Lisl is getting the recognition that she might be overdue for with the book, with the exhibition, and then also that she lived long enough to be honored during her life with the AIA Gold Award, as well as being elevated to the College of Fellows. So final question, I know we're bumping up against time here, but there's been some concerted efforts to make sure that the achievements of women in fields of architecture are not going unrecognized. So is it still important to be having conversations about women in the field of architecture today? Have we moved past that? Any final closing thoughts?
Well, there's a new women in architecture group at the AIA, right? And it wildly successful. The number of attendees at a symposium last fall, I think, doubled the number they expected. And so it seems, yes, we should still talk about it. But I think we are architects that are women.
Right.
That's and that we're doing architecture, and that our work also, like Lisl believed, it should speak for ourselves. And so I don't think there should be compensation for, we don't need a handicap to,
right,
to be a female architect. We're architects. We are completely able to prove what we do through our work.
Mm-hmm. I would say, while it's not maybe ideal today, it's much better. But if you go back in time, if you do research, if you try to research women architects of Lisl's era, it's very difficult to find much documentation. They just simply were not written about. Part of that in Lisl's case has to do with so many women in Europe had to leave Europe during the war or in the wake of the war. They went, people don't really know where, but there's very little historical record on this. It's funny, I'm seeing every once in a while, I get an email from somebody who's starting to do research on this woman or starting to do research on that woman. So I think it's beginning to happen, but it is disheartening as a researcher because you just can't find the record, but yet you know that there were women architects. So I think that's changing, and it's been fun to be a part of that.
One of the things I would add is that the field itself, the way we practice, the way things are publicized, is very masculine oriented, just in the way what's preferred, the aesthetics and so on, I think are very male. And so I think that's going to be something that's going to change. It's going to evolve. But I don't think it really has begun in the way it will eventually. So I think that's something I'm looking forward to seeing happen.
Interesting.
Well, the book is just a gem, and you'll all get a chance to see it. But it is just fantastic in the way that it highlights Lisl's work. And I visited David and Gladys Sommel last weekend, and in the work of David's work, I see this similarity of modernism, of course, but in the simple materials, things like homosote and plywood and all of that, and the efficient use of space, the two spaces, just Lisl's work and having been at David's house, there's a lot of shared values there.
And I think the modesty of the work that she did, and the way she wasn't interested in the publicity, that wasn't the reason that she practiced. She practiced for other reasons.
It's a really good read, the book is. Mm-hmm. Your writing is wonderful.
Really comes forward.
Thank you. There's information outside on how to pre-order it, and then also a book signing coming up. So I know we had originally intended to be done by now, but maybe we can take a few questions from the audience, and anyone who needs to leave can. Go ahead.
Julia, I'd love to hear your ideas about how architecture design will be different with a feminine perspective.
Well, actually, we were talking about this the other day, about one of the things that we both agreed upon, and I don't know to what extent you could actually do research on it, but was that women tend to design buildings from the inside out. So they're really interested in what happens on the inside, how the thing operates, whereas not everybody, of course, but many men tend to design from the way the building looks and the way it sits in the context. And so there's two different things, and they balance each other, so they are important both. But I think that in the past, those buildings that have gotten awards have not always even functioned very well. They look good, and sometimes they are kind of disasters in other ways. So I think that that's changing, and I think it has something to do with women being in the field, and also has something to do with the fact that we're more interested in research and finding out how it really worked. But I think that's something that is really worth paying attention to.
Other questions? Yeah.
I had heard that when Franklin Wright built a house in Merle Stillwater for the Lovelaces, that Virginia told Mr. Wright in no uncertain terms what she wanted and he would have to do, and he actually listened to her, which apparently was unusual. Did Lisl listen in her career to the people that she was building houses for? Any examples of that?
Yes, she did listen. She listened intensely, as a matter of fact, and she had a form that she used. She found a book in the 30s called Build Your House to Suit Yourself, and it had a survey in it in which the homeowner, the theory was, if you want a home that works for you, you have to convey to your architect what you need, spatially, what you own, what you want, how do you like sun, whatever. And so she would have them fill out this form, and she would talk to them about, you know, exactly what they wanted in a house. I have heard from, I know Julia was one person, several other people, Gar Hargens has said this, she had a good relationship with her clients, and they liked her, and she did listen. I'd like to say about Frank Lloyd Wright, though, I think he gets a little bit of a bad rap, because I think if you read the correspondence, he had some very good relationships and working relationships with some of his clients, perhaps finances aside.
Other questions? Yes.
How do you see the gender breakdown in the architecture education now?
Today we have about, I guess it's pretty much as what you were saying, it's about one-third female students.
Yep.
We had about 50-50 in my class.
Me too.
Yeah, no,
but I think what I hear is that often the class graduates with a fair number of females, but then the females don't keep working. And I think you might even be an example for us.
Yes.
Right? Yes, you have a degree in architecture, and you are with kids, right? Because it's demanding. It's demanding. It's just such a hard field to to do it all.
It's true.
Would anyone? There are a couple of homeowners in the audience. Would anyone? Not to put you on the spot, no one knows who you are, but does anyone want to say anything about their Lisl Close house? I can, yeah. Yes?
I will tell you that Roy Close and his wife and Lisl came to visit us at our home in Mankato, Minnesota. And somewhere along the line, we were kind of thinking about remodeling the kitchen because it was still original. And I did not dare say that. But then, as an aside, Roy said to me, when I said, what were you thinking about? He said, my mom didn't care about the kitchen. So he actually did ask for help from an architect here in Minneapolis who lived in another room.
Someone who cooked.
I think they would have approved. I have a daughter, and I was able to have the privilege of growing up in that house, and it was such a spectacular home, and I didn't understand it at the time when I was young, but the way the light comes in and how the seasons change and the view, it's wonderful. So they're taking very good care of it.
Yes.
It's great.
I was going to say something too. Roger and I are second owners of the Close home, and when we found out the house was for sale, I said, this looks like it was done by an architect. And the realtor said, well, there's some plants out in the garage. Let's look. We invited the Closes out to dinner because we wanted to talk about the house. And they just came out all the time as we were moving in and told us stories about the house and how this was done by that. And from the other side, as we lived in it, there were times I would just say, I have to call them up and thank them for the way they put this window in. I would call up periodically. And I think it's a house that is now 60 years old and it still lives so well. They designed it so
amazing.
Well.
Yeah.
It's on Good Lane. It's just southwest of Rosedale. It's still a little residential area.
It's a great house.
Yes. It's very nicely in acre and a half of woods. And the stories were all, too, that Lisl stood in front of trees so that
one of the facts that I look back and saw in my notes was that Lisl said that she was always on construction sites twice a week. That's a lot to be on a construction site and have other things to do. So I'm sure that is in part why the houses are so beautiful too, because the details are so great on those houses, on all of her houses.
She showed me too about the smooth design of the woodwork around the doors, and then the door was flush with the wall, and so we wouldn't have to dust it. The contractors hated it because it was an overlook that I mistake. So she had to supervise it.
Right, yes.
A small person, but formidable.
Right, right. It was a lot of unconventional details. They don't just happen. Yeah, I would imagine that she needed to be there.
Yes.
My wife, Brenda, and I, and my name is Jeff, have the privilege of living in an Elizabeth Post house on the on the west side of Cedar Lake at the intersection of Franklin. And our story is that we were in a contemporary home, or I should say a modern home, and we love modern architecture. And we actually thought that this was such a great building site that we could do something just stunningly cubular. We live on a budget and we have to watch our dollars, and so we moved into the house and wanted to feel it for a while. And of course, ma'am, you with the red jacket, you said she was interested in designing houses that people would love. I think is what you said. So that's what happened. We moved in the house, and we rubbed our elbows against the walls, and we moved around inside of the house, and made the decision that there's no way we would change anything. We hired Gar Harmons to be our. We're pretty independent, and we knew what we wanted to do, but you also have to know what you don't know. Mm-hmm. And so we hired Gar to stop us from doing something.
Which he did gladly.
Yeah. And so there were a lot of consultations inside the house where we would, tape up a mock-up and what if we do this and what if we do that and will that be a mistake? And I believe that Gar is really happy and that we did not make a mistake. And this is our pine box house, and neighbors come by and say, let us know when you want to sell, because maybe they thought we were flippers or something like that. And they said, you'll know when there's a person in the driveway. And a week later, I saw the same guy, and I said, that was wrong. You'll know when the second person
is. Is this the house right on Cedar Lake and that was recently renovated?
Yeah. Yep.
It's beautiful.
Somebody took a picture of the front of our house and put it on the back page of the website. But just one little teeny piece of the entire experience is that Elizabeth figured out how to put a railing, a closed railing on the lake side of the house, which allows one to see the skyline, all of the parkboard trees on the far side of the lake, all of the water, and none of the road. And how she figured out how to sit in the house on the sofa, in the great room, and know that that was going to happen is incredible. So your industry as architects to be able to do that in your imagination, so that folks like us get to enjoy it, is truly phenomenal. And at the end of the day, we ended up doing a loving restoration. We took the house apart completely. It's got all new plumbing, all new electric, all new heating, but we never moved a stud. And for example, so you know, is the plaster with asbestos in it all gone? Yes. Is there drywall? Yes. On the outside of the house, every single piece of the 1954 Pacific Northwest redwood was taken off a piece at a time, carefully sanded, re-sickened, and then put back on the house by our carpenter, each in exactly the same place, like a puzzle. And it was so fun to fall in love with the process of honoring great architecture. And then it doesn't stop there. All of our neighbors, everybody stops and wants to talk about what's going to happen next week or whatever, you know. So it just touches people and their hearts are warmed and there's more love because of great architecture. So thanks for what you guys, what we stumbled into.
So great.
Somehow we're smart enough not to screw up.
That's so great.
That would please her very much, I'm sure.
Yeah.
We're very
that would please her very much to hear this.
And we're grateful that you took taking such good care. Yeah. And we'd love it if you'd let us all in.
Yes, we would.
Maybe it's on the board that comes in red. She and I chatted. And, so we don't want to like have a Parade of Homes experience because we're kind of private.
Just Homes for Architects.
You guys are all, you know, it's not that way. So we're going to be honored to do that.
Great.
That'd be fantastic. Wonderful.
So does you guys include us in the
I believe that the Joe Momo, did I say that right?
You did?
Yes.
Okay. We joined so we could come here.
Oh, fantastic. Oh, wonderful.
I believe that they will figure out how to.
So those of us who aren't members should join.
Yes.
And wouldn't it be wonderful to have four houses on a little tour? To see four of her pieces of work.
Yeah.
If anybody else in a house wants to share, talk to her.
We'd love to put that
We have done that, and actually Gladys and Roger are always very generous about opening their house, and it has been done in the past. But owners change, and so you need to make new relationships. Love to talk to you afterwards. but it's lovely to hear that the homes endure. And you know, that's sort of the heart of what she was trying to do. She wanted something that was going to last and serve the client well, and people were going to be happy. And by that, she meant the next generation of clients, too, I think.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's a great way to end the program tonight. So thank you, everyone, for coming.
Yeah, thank you.